Cheryl 3 years ago when I was attending a medical conference and she was an invited speaker. And she knocked my socks off. It's taken me 3 years to pull her from her international travel schedule to get her into San Francisco to speak. On Tuesday, she spoke at the Commonwealth Club and we had a really nice size audience. And they were easy to introduce her to because they don't have the knowledge that you all have. So I stand here, frankly, quite intimidated to try to say, oh my God, what can I say to you? So I'm not going to, I'm gonna let her do that. But what I will tell you is that she's an international lecturer. She's an author of multiple books, one of which is so out of print you could probably only find it if you pay somebody hundreds of dollars. She has her own radio talk show with some incredible guests who will not make the time unless somebody of Cheryl's credentials is inviting them. In Phil's handout, the fellow who wrote the book spoke to him as somebody who was integrative. And this is why Cheryl knocked my socks off, because the basic statement that a surgeon only knows how to cut is a problem I have when listening to people. When I listen to someone like Cheryl, who knows so many different breaths with so much experience from China to the US, from Western to complementary, she pulls everything into the picture. And that's frankly what I need and what I think a lot of people need. So I just want to introduce Cheryl Selman, who I think is unbelievably amazing.
Thank you, Adria.
Are you hooked up with the other one? Okay, let me have the other one. I think you're okay.
Oh, I'm okay. Yeah. I'm already mic'd. Good. Thank you. Thank you, Adria. It's a pleasure to be here. I've actually come all the way from Tulsa, Oklahoma, where I live, to be here. So it's, of course, it doesn't take much to bring me to San Francisco, even though it is a moldy place, but it couldn't be any moldier than Tulsa, Oklahoma. So anyway, how much time do I have? Can someone?
Well, why don't we go until 9:30 and then take questions?
Okay. Well, I have a power-packed, information-filled presentation, so I want to be sure to give you as much as Dave was able to give you too. So I have lots of topics that relate to not only the issue at hand, but what was brought up in the earlier presentation, earlier discussion. So we're gonna meld a lot of these issues and try to give you a sense, a context in which to understand the challenges that we're faced by. So how many of you have hormones? Does anybody have no hormones? Anybody have too many hormones? So we're going to be talking about hormones, and obviously I'm a woman and I know mostly about women's hormones, but we are going to talk a bit about men and their challenges, and again create a bigger picture of what's going on with hormones. And I will be around afterwards so we can do some more discussions and some testings of things if people would like. My journey, first of all, I am a naturopathic doctor and I'm a psychotherapist and I am an author. My first book was called Hormone Heresy, What Women Must Know. My second book is called, which is kind of the follow-on of the research that I have been doing. It's called What Women Must Know to Protect Their Daughters from Breast Cancer. I've noticed a growing awareness of the concern about our young daughters and the risk that they're facing, not only for hormonal issues, but of something wrong?
Yeah. I thought it was a little loud.
Is it too loud? No. They'll have to mind. Anyway, the fact that we have 20 and 30-year-old girls, women, being diagnosed with breast cancer, which is a phenomenon that has never existed before. The younger you are when you're diagnosed with breast cancer, the worse the prognosis, and more likely to actually die of the disease. So this is an issue coming to the fore. I've been writing about this for many years, and there are things we need to know to protect our children. I've just finished my third book, which is coming out in October, a very different subject. It's a book about Salba, which we have samples of for you here, which is one of the most nutrient-dense, fiber-rich whole seeds that you can possibly eat, and we'll talk a bit about that. And I do have some samples and some of my articles, and even a recipe for a Salba coconut banana, gluten-free, sugar-free, fabulous muffin recipe. So for all of those who are gluten-free and fungus challenge, this is a perfect recipe. So we have all sorts of things, and I you know, when I lecture, I really like to give you as many resources that you can possibly use. My journey began in my mid-40s. I was very successful, very busy doing my work as a psychotherapist. I was working 48 weekends out of the year, 60, 70, 80 hours a week. I was into the high-carb phase, eating lots of pasta at the time, very stressed, not sleeping very well, and, you know, it's your typical corporate lifestyle, which we reward in our culture. And it's a destructive lifestyle at the best of times, but for women, it's truly a disaster. And for me, it showed up with a variety of symptoms, and it started out with anxiety attacks, which I was getting at about 3, 4 a.m. every night. As a psychotherapist, I thought for sure it was some deep-seated issue that I had to resolve, which it wasn't, because it never resolved through my psychotherapeutic tools. My mic is fooling. How about here? No, that's not good. Here? Okay. I also found that I was waking up really tired. Anyone relate to that? You know, you think you're having a good night's sleep, and you wake up and you feel worse than when you went to bed. I also had major episodes of depression for quite a number of years. I had low libido. I was struggling with weight, and then really the key to all of this happened when I was getting what, gentlemen, we call night sweats. Anyone know what I'm talking about here? We wake up and in the middle of the night, drenched. And that was the clue that I was dealing with hormonal issues. So out of that experience, it led me to really begin to look at an issue that I knew nothing about, had no experience with, and probably avoided for most of my life, and that is understanding my own female physiology and what was happening with my hormones. And I wanted solutions because I was waking up at midnight drenched with these night sweats. I was then finally getting back to bed when the anxiety attacks would wake me up. Anxiety is a huge problem in our society. So is insomnia. And if we don't get a good, solid 7 to 8 hours sleep a night, our immune system is compromised, we can't lose weight, we can't think, we can't remember, we can't learn, we can't detoxify, we really can't be healthy. And I wasn't getting much sleep. And so, with my hormone havoc going on, I was desperate to find solutions. I chose to go a more holistic approach, because if I had gone to a doctor back then, HRT would have been the drug of choice at the time, but drugs are not in my paradigm. So I began to investigate what was going on. And in the course of investigating my needs, I, like Alice in Wonderland, stumbled into the rabbit hole and found a world of deceit, deception, myths and lies in the way that women have been treated, the way we have been taught to understand our bodies, our cycles, and the very essence of who we are as a female. And so my mission was discovered. And I was really angry at what I was discovering, because I realized that how we were being treated for the various issues was so damaging and life-threatening, and sometimes it actually took women's lives, that I chose to take the anger and turn it into action. And I began to write, and that was what ultimately culminated in Hormone Heresy. And I continue to write, and the journey just goes on and on and on. So tonight is a journey that I'd like to share with you, to give you a context of what's happening and to help you with some solutions perhaps, and just f- for the women and for the men. Men to appreciate the women in your lives, but also men to understand more of what's going on in their bodies as well. So we can really step into a level of empowerment. We can't make informed choices if we don't know what's really going on. And that's true for anything, whether it's our bodies, whether it's politics, and most of what's going on we don't have a clue about anyway. So we have to get enlightened with truthful information. So I have no agendas other than really doing my best to share with you the 15, 16 years of research that I've put into this issue, continue to put into this issue, and other dynamics like the EMFs, which we're going to talk about, and their effect on hormones and molds and everything else. So, okay, so we're going to start this journey. And in order to really understand, let's just see. And how we got to where we are, where women are being medicalized and pathologized for profit, we need to have a bit of history. There's a saying that I came across and I really like, and it says, history is written by the winners. And when it comes to the history of women's health, the winners are the patriarchal system. So we have to go back in time 2,500 years ago to this guy. You've heard of him, Hippocrates. He has some very famous quotes attributed to him, but there's probably one quote you haven't come across that he said, and it was a rhetorical question. He said, "What is woman?" And his response rhetorically was, "Disease." So that kind of frames the last 2,500 years of how women's bodies have been perceived. Basically, we as women are innately flawed because we're not men. And as a result of being innately flawed because we have ovaries and a uterus, then we are the parts of us that make us uniquely female are also our greatest enemies. And the system has attacked them and removed them. And this started all the way back. They were doing this in the Victorian era, removing women's uteruses for the sake of keeping them docile so they wouldn't get divorced and own their own money. So we have a very interesting history when you get into it, and a lot of my books actually go into the historical context because it's fascinating to know how we got to where we... Oh, I'm sorry, wrong button I'm pushing. Okay, so we live in more modern, enlightened times, right? So this is a very seminal book. It's called Feminine Forever. Does anyone remember this book? Because this was a bestseller in 1966. It sold hundreds of thousands of copies, and it set us on a course of treatment. And basically, Dr. Robert Wilson, a gynecologist, president of the Gynecological Association, well-respected man, did a study. And based on his study, he wrote a book. And in Feminine Forever, he said, menopause is a time of decay. A woman becomes a caricature of her former self. And other flattering comments about menopausal women, and he was going to save us from this living decay, quote unquote. And what was his solution? Estrogen replacement therapy. So he taught us that for us to be feminine forever, to stay young and juicy, wrinkle-free, sexually, you know, ready to go, we must take estrogen. And did we buy it? Hook, line, and sinker. You know, and this became an era of estrogen replacement therapy. 1966 to 1976, thousands and thousands of women begged their doctors to put them on estrogen. And that ended abruptly in 1976, when two studies came out simultaneously explaining why there was an 800% increase in uterine cancer in the previous 10 years. Because the only known cause of uterine cancer to this day is from excess estrogen. So menopausal women at that time, with and without a uterus, were all put on estrogen replacement therapy. footnote, a little footnote to the situation. The one study that Dr. Robert Wilson did was deemed flawed by the FDA. He was discredited as a researcher, but he became very wealthy, not only because his book became a bestseller, but because he had a trust fund to which $1 million was given. By whom? The companies producing estrogen. So, when those studies were revealed, women were irate, furious, turned their backs. And of course, the drug companies lost a fortune. So what did they do? They created something new. They went, oh my God, we're sorry, we just did estrogen without progesterone like the body should be doing, but progesterone can't be patented, so we'll make a new drug, call it a progestin, and now we'll put women on hormone replacement therapy. But women went, we have short memories, actually. Women go, no. They, you know, fresh thought, uterine cancer. What's the treatment for uterine cancer? Does anyone know? What's the common treatment for uterine cancer? It's a hysterectomy. Hysterectomy is the common treatment, if you survive. And as anyone may know who's had a hysterectomy, it is a dire invasive surgery that should be avoided at all cost. And 90 to 95% of hysterectomies are not medically imperative. And in the United States, we have about 1 million women a year having a hysterectomy. And generally, that's removing the uterus, but generally, if you're over the age of 35, they'll whip out the ovaries as well because it'll save you from the potential risk of developing what? Ovarian cancer. And what is your risk of developing ovarian cancer? 4%. Slight. So, anyway, I don't want to dwell on this, but they developed HRT. How did they get us to go back on it? They created a new disorder. What was it? Osteoporosis. It was never, 70% of people in the 1980s never heard about osteoporosis. We had to be educated that this was a problem. They made it a woman's problem. Is it a woman's problem? No. They made it a woman's problem. They made menopause the source of the problem, the condition, and they found the solution, HRT. Were there any studies ever done up to this point showing the safety or the efficacy of this drug? None. Never. They've known since the 1940s, actually, that estrogen caused cancer. So you know, we have been misled along the way, and women have suffered and died. It wasn't until 2002 with this big study, Women's Health Initiative, that was ended 3 years earlier because they were already getting results of a huge increase in breast cancer in women on the HRT, as well as strokes and blood clots, so they ended it early. Major medical disaster, and we all thought, hallelujah, the end of a major medical mistake, but we were wrong. So, we need to know that the United States government, and every 2 years, they put out these reports on known carcinogens, and the 10th report listed all steroidal estrogens as known human carcinogens. Previously, they said progestins, the other ingredient in HRT, or in birth control pills, which happen to have the same similar hormones only in higher doses in the birth control pill, is also a known human carcinogen. Premarin was known to be, which is made from the urine of pregnant mares, it's an estrogen. That was known to be a carcinogen way back in the 4th report. But the 9th report also had another drug that was listed as a known human carcinogen. What's the number one drug given to prevent recurrence of breast cancer for women? Tamoxifen. The 9th report listed tamoxifen as a known human carcinogen.
And mycotoxin.
So, the answer, the question is, you know, what is it about the word carcinogen we don't understand? Now, even bioidentical hormones, which have become more popular. The natural progesterone, which is the same molecular match as what your body makes, is in a bioidentical formulation. And also estrogens, plant-based estrogens, which are in the HRT formulas now as well. So when I wrote Hormone Heresy, I was a big fan, and I still am supportive of progesterone for women, but I have gone so far beyond just using progesterone. But what I want to say is that unless you get proper assessment of your hormone levels, and this is true for men as well as women, through saliva testing, if you don't actually assess your hormone levels, and if you don't truly have estrogen deficiency as shown by saliva testing, and you are put on a bioidentical hormone formula that includes estrogen, and you don't need estrogen, that estrogen, even though it's plant-based, is still as toxic and can increase the risk of cancers as any other form of HRT. Because an estrogen is an estrogen and is an estrogen, and it proliferates cell growth, and it causes inflammation, and it probably lets cancers feed as, I mean, fungus feed as well, I'm sure, because it's so pro-inflammatory. So you need to know what you're doing. Now, there are a few other things going on. Right now, there is a huge effort by the pharmaceutical industry to medicalize and pathologize menstruation. Have you noticed? There are ads on television. What they're telling our young women? They're telling young women that their menstrual cycles are messy, inconvenient, unnecessary, and you can control them by taking a pill that basically suppresses your menstrual cycle for a year or two or three, however long you choose to have. And there are ads on television. But what we don't realize, and I learned this when I was going through my transformation, really reclaiming my own feminine self and wisdom through my menstrual cycle, was that our menstrual cycle is a source of power and wisdom for women. You suppress a menstrual cycle and a woman totally disconnects from her inner self, her inner authority, her emotions. Not to mention the fact that the pill, as the Lancet says, increases the incidence of breast cancer by 60%. The younger you are when you use it, the greater the risk of developing breast cancer later in your life. And not only that, the pill increases your risk of blood clots, strokes, infertility, low libido, depression. It will rob the body of vitamin C, vitamin E, zinc, magnesium, selenium, tyrosine needed for your thyroid, B6, B12, folic acid. It's not a really good idea, especially because most women are put on the pill not for contraceptive purposes any longer. Why are young girls put on the pill? Heavy periods, painful periods, lack of periods, you know, polycystic ovarian syndrome, endometriosis, ovarian cysts, acne. 12-year-old girls are put on the pill for acne. These are girls that are already compromised in their health, or they wouldn't be having menstrual problems or reproductive abnormalities. And then you put them on a pill that depletes key vitamins and minerals, that puts them at risk of stroke, of blood clots, that can increase the risk of cancer and cause all these other issues. One of the quotes that I like to share with people, it came from the Wall Street Journal, and it was by a billionaire who makes fertility drugs. And what does he say? He says our best customers are women in the 30s who took the pill as teenagers and 20-year-olds. And in our society, we think the pill is like taking candy. It is safe. Doctors are never warning their patients of the risks and never addressing the underlying root cause issues. So the use of the pill leads to more chronic health problems in women down the track, including increasing their incidence of breast cancer. Yes.
Whatever gave anybody the idea when they came out with the birth control pill that was somehow a red hot idea to take Mother Nature out and put a new program into a woman's body?
Well, it was believed that it gave women control over their fertility in the 1960s. That was turning out to be a huge issue. And, you know, it does. But there's consequences. And then it's become an industry, and it's just, you know, it was only to be used for a short period of time, like between pregnancies, and never to be used over the age of 35. Now the pill is a treatment given to perimenopausal women. I know women who've been taking the pill up until 50s, and that's when they start switching over to HRT.
Yeah,
So here are some myths. I just want to cover some of the myths. Now, some of these myths have been established in our society as truth, so we need to turn it upside down and get the story straight. So the myths. Here are the myths. Menopause is a downhill slide. Thank you, Robert Wilson. Our ovaries fail and cease to produce estrogen at menopause. Hot flashes are inevitable. You know, women brace themselves when they feel they're going into menopause, just waiting for the guillotine to fall. Estrogen deficiency occurs at menopause. In fact, estrogen deficiency is perceived as the primary hormone thing that starts to happen. Actually, it happens at perimenopause, we're told. And then we talk about the pill, and I can give you a whole lecture just on the consequences of the pill and what we're doing to women on the pill, that's safe and wonderful. But here are the facts, because the facts are a very different story, and these facts really empower us to make those decisions we need to make and to also embrace who we are. So first of all, as a menopausal, postmenopausal woman now, let me tell you that when you have this knowledge, you move into the cycle of your life, into a place of the greatest power you will ever experience in this lifetime. In fact, everything that you've been experiencing up into your life is preparing you to enter a time when it all comes together and distilled as power. Am I right, women? Yeah. Menopausal women, this is a time of our power. We need to reclaim it because the patriarchal culture tells us we lose all value and sense of self. And in actual fact, that's designed to keep us from knowing who we really are, which is our power. When I began this work, when I wrote Hormone Heresy, the first offer I got from the media was to go, this is in Australia, to go on national television in a current affairs show. And it's like, does that have to be the first thing? You know, it's like, oh my God, who am I? I'm not a naturopath. I'm just, at that point, a woman who felt I needed to get the message out. So, okay, I went on the show, terrified. I did okay. I must have done okay because they invited me back a week later. Now they invited me back to debate an endocrinologist on television. It's like, what have I done? You know, and I figured this is the biggest test because if I can survive this, you know, it's clear sailing. And so I had a lot of coaching, and it was a woman endocrinologist, a highly respected endocrinologist who just was the biggest bitch you ever could find. And it was a sorry day in her life to be on television with me. It's all I could say. So it was. It was a great sense of accomplishment because, you know, I knew exactly what she was going to do and how she was going to discredit me, so I cut her off at the pass. And she never learned her lesson. She debated me about three other times on TV and radio. I, Susan, don't you get it? You're never going to win because you're not telling women the truth. And so it was, you know, this was my personal experience of stepping into a level of power I never thought I would ever be able to do. And there's a great saying, there's a book out there, you might have heard about it from many years ago. It says, and this is typifies a menopausal woman, what other people think of me is none of my business. And I think that's where we get to, finally, after all we go through in our life, to get to a cycle and a stage where we really have a sense of inner authority and we believe in ourselves. Yeah, do you have? Yeah, exactly. So, it's an empowering time. Our ovaries do not give up the ghost. We don't have defective parts. The ovaries continue to function the entire length of our lives. However, we reduce the amount of hormones being produced because we're not in a reproductive cycle. We've done that, move on to other things. So we reduce the amount of estrogen about 40 to 60%. We have a huge drop in progesterone because you must ovulate to make progesterone. So we're not making progesterone in menopause by our ovaries, but our body has a backup system. And the backup system happens to be our adrenal glands and the fat cells, which can make estrogen. We're not left in a lurch. In fact, an overweight postmenopausal woman has more estrogen circulating in her body than a skinny premenopausal woman. Our body is adjusting, we're shifting gears, but we're not left out in the cold. We're just making adjustments, but we need to know how to support those adjustments so we can make the most and support the needs at that stage of our life. Another myth that we need to understand, that All hormonal imbalance, and you'll hear me say this over and over again, is a symptom of poor health. Hot flashes are not inevitable. There are cultures like the Japanese that have never known hot flashes, not until they have been introduced to McDonald's and KFC. And now, you want to learn a little Japanese? You want to learn the Japanese word for hot flash? They now have a word for hot flash. You ready? This is a Japanese word for hot flash, so you may need to practice it a few times. Hot flash. They learned it from us. So, estrogen excess, as was mentioned before by several people, our main problem for men as well as women is the fact that we have the highest levels of estrogen ever circulating in our bodies, probably any time in history. From what we're eating, the foods we're eating, the stresses we're under, from the environmental toxins, from a toxic liver that can't properly metabolize it, from those darn fungus, all those things are leading us to a result of high estrogen levels. It's showing up in our weight, in inflammation, in thyroid issues, in depression. It's showing up in large prostates and putting on the weight. You know, men that are starting to develop breasts, it's a range of problems. High estrogen levels, a major problem. Estrogen, perimenopause, the 5 to 10 years before a woman enters menopause, which is defined as 12 complete months without a menstrual cycle, is not a time of declining estrogen levels as the ovaries start to wind down. It is a time when the ovary is making some of the highest amounts of estrogen in her entire life, because it's like the final hurrah. The pituitary is trying to get that ovary to kick in one more time, and what we have found is that it is a time of high estrogen levels with accompanying low progesterone levels, because we're not ovulating regularly every month, not making that vital hormone. And what can I say? The pill, the term of the pill is called chemical castration, and it works by shutting down the ovaries, taking them offline. I have talked to women who go, you know, I've been on the pill for 30 years and I have a menstrual cycle every month. And I often ask women, how many people, you know, on the pill, and they all raise their hands, how many of you are having periods? They all raise their hands. I go, well, here's some information you probably don't know, obviously don't know. You've never had a period as long as you're on the pill. The pill causes you to have a forced bleed. Just like women on HRT in their 60s, 70s, and 80s are forced to have a false bleed through the use of HRT. It is not a menstrual cycle. It will never be a menstrual cycle. And these women all think that they've been menstruating every month for years. They've been commandeered by synthetic carcinogenic hormones. So we'll go through this really quickly, because there's some symptoms that you may recognize, men and women, of what we call estrogen dominance, which is pretty well established now, at least by integrative medical doctors and holistic practitioners, and verified through saliva testing. You know, it causes, estrogen is pro-inflammatory. So what will it do? It will increase allergies, autoimmune diseases, it causes breast tenderness, it will lower your sex drive, fatigue, fat gain, abdomen weight, thighs, because of its interference with thyroid hormones. Estrogen blocks the uptake of thyroid. So you tend to get more hypothyroid, and you start putting the weight, and you feel tired, and you get depressed. You have foggy thinking. It causes more gallbladder disease, primarily because of, it interferes with digestion and causes inflammation. Headaches, hypoglycemia, blood clots, strokes, infertility, irritability, memory loss, migraines, miscarriage, osteoporosis, actually, the sign of estrogen dominance, and PMS, fibroids, water retention, and so on and so forth. Anyone relate to any of those symptoms? You know, they're so common in our culture right now. So, if you have hormonal issues, you need to understand something really important. It isn't the curse of being a female. It isn't about menopause. It's because you are profoundly out of balance. And what is going on? What's out of balance? And this is what I've learned for myself over the years, because I started out taking progesterone cream and thinking, I'm estrogen dominant, I need progesterone. But then I started asking, but why am I estrogen dominant? What's that about? So here are some of the root cause issues that I use when I work with women. These are the issues we work on. When women have hormonal problems, and by the way, there are no simple hormonal problems anymore. Everything is very complicated. People have so many issues. It takes a lot of work because there's chronic inflammation and there's chronic toxicity, and we have, you know, major digestive issues and liver issues and exhausted adrenals. There is a woman that I've tested that isn't in some stage of adrenal exhaustion. So these are the things we all have to work on. We have to look at these are the underlying causes that contribute to hormonal imbalance. Hypothyroidism, adrenal exhaustion, liver issues, insulin resistance, poor digestion, candida, can't forget that, inflammation, and then we have major deficiencies because we are not able to properly digest and assimilate our food. That is why you have hormonal issues, and those are the things you've got to sort out, which ones are more prevalent for you. You've got to get healthy.
Well, you know, John Lee and that woman who's taken over for him.
Virginia,
what's her last name?
Hopkins.
Virginia Hopkins. She has this other view, though, that estrogen, the hormone imbalance is due to the fact that women stop ovulating and therefore make only maybe 5% or less of the progesterone that they were making before. Sometimes almost none. And
well,
that's why there's estrogen dominance. I mean, why doesn't that answer the question?
No, because women weren't always estrogen dominant.
That's true, because women have always tended to put weight on as they approach their 40s. Historically, you have women spread.
Yes, but there are a lot of reasons why that's going on, and not all.
Historically.
Well, I don't want to argue the point. The fact is that we have some chronic imbalances occurring with conditions that have never existed before. If our adrenal glands are strong, our adrenals actually can support us in making progesterone or progesterone-like hormones. But the fact is that I've tested 20-year-olds with exhausted adrenal glands. Our adrenals are fundamental to our hormonal balance, and that is a big problem that's under huge siege. And adrenal exhaustion or stage one, you have high cortisol, which increases estrogen and blocks progesterone. There are a lot of issues going on. I mean, I know John Lee. I brought him to Australia. He's a mentor of mine. And yes, at that time we were looking at these things, but even John in his books moved on and looked at adrenals and looked at all these other issues as major contributing factors to estrogen dominance. So, we're not healthy. We've been a really toxic culture, and our hormones have really suffered. So we have to get back. I mean, I really am committed to my health. I don't even take progesterone anymore. I'm healthier now at 60 than I was at 44 when I began. I want everyone to understand that we can get younger and healthier as we get older. It takes commitment. It takes learning. It takes the willingness to do whatever it takes, whatever it takes. But I have a strong belief, and this is the model I work with, we can get younger and healthier as we get older. And my personal experience shows that to me. I also have another model or another belief that I carry, and I want to die healthy. Very novel idea. And it's challenging. We have lots of things impacting on us, which is the gift of this group, is to give us more awareness so we can negotiate with the greatest amount of consciousness and wisdom so we can make the best choices. Is it easy? Everything's stacked against us in our society. I mean, go to a supermarket and what is there that you can eat? Nothing. So, you're an enlightened group. I'm not going to spend too much time, but we know the hormone wreckers are your usual suspects. Carbs, refined anything, caffeine, alcohol, the bad fats, dehydration. It's really important to stay hydrated with good quality water. And stress, the number one hormone disruptor of all times is stress. So when we have hot flashes, what I want to say, and you can look at some of the suggestions, hot flashes indicate the issue is primarily around our liver. Some adrenals, but primarily around our liver. And there are numerous things we could be doing to really support the proper liver support and get those hormones back on track. And, from vitamins to herbs to spices to really help us. But to me, is anyone found that when they have menstrual cycles, first of all, they have a lot of cramps with menstrual cycles? That's always a sign of liver issue. And if you have blood clots in your menstrual blood, liver. In Chinese medicine, that's one of the primary indicators of a liver issue with your menstrual cycle. So you have to look at your liver. Now, I'm going to move on. Night sweats. Remember I told you I had tons of night sweats going on? Now you go to a doctor, he'll go, well, night sweats are hot flashes at night. But night sweats are not hot flashes at night. Night sweats are about adrenal exhaustion. Your night sweats are more about your adrenal issues. So if you're experiencing night sweats or insomnia, if you wake up tired and are tired throughout the day, but then get that burst of energy at night, who gets that burst of energy at night? Well, you are experiencing adrenal exhaustion, adrenal dysregulation because, and generally it's stage one adrenal exhaustion, because if your adrenals were working optimally, you would have wake up with tons of energy, highest levels of adrenal, your cortisol during the morning, highest levels, and as the day, it continues to go down, and at night, it gets to the lowest point, and you start getting tired and go to sleep. But if you get that surge, you're dysregulated. You're doing the opposite of what you should be because you're way out of whack. Your rhythms are out of whack. And one of the most important things for adrenal exhaustion, aside from, you know, many of these things we'll talk about, is getting to bed by 10 p.m.
Another thing, not sitting under bright fluorescent lights near 10 p.m. without sunglasses.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that because, thank you, you didn't even know you were talking. There's a website called Low Blue Lights. Do you know about that website?
I know that website.
Low Blue Lights, and it's a fantastic website. I do have a radio show. I interviewed the professor, the doctor who has started that company. He was a major researcher out of GE working with light, and he believes one of the primary causes of our cancer epidemic happens to be lights at night, which suppresses melatonin levels, which we'll get into in a little bit. And he has developed a type of light that has a yellow glass, which mimics, it filters out the blue rays, so it tells the brain that you actually are going into twilight and nighttime. So if you put these yellow bulbs in your home, he has glasses, like sunglasses that are with those that yellow glass that you wear at night. You can even put a yellow type of plastic covering over your computer screens. It will let your body think you're going into nighttime and start the release of melatonin, which we will about see why it's so important. And this is a night light. So to support melatonin, you have to sleep in the dark, total darkness. And you need to be in bed by 10 p.m. or else you need to take some melatonin, especially if you're a night shift worker. But this is a little night light, has a yellow light, which will not suppress melatonin if you get up in the middle of the night. But you must sleep in total darkness. I now sleep with a sleep mask for total darkness, and it's made a huge difference.
I would say if you have blue LED,
yeah, and this is not going to be a popular message in this crowd, I have a feeling. But those energy-saving compact fluorescents, those great things that, you know, by 2020, it's going to be illegal to have incandescent light bulbs, so now we have to get all our compact fluorescents, which are only made in China, in the United States. Not only, of course, is compact fluorescence, you have mercury vapors being emitted, but you have high emissions of EMFs, much higher than in those incandescent light bulbs.
There are no mercury vapors emitted. That's a lot.
Huh?
There are no mercury vapors emitted as long as the bulb is intact.
Well, that could be a problem if you happen to drop your bulb on the floor, because you can't even vacuum. There's a senator in the House, a representative actually, a congressman, who stood up in Congress and read the FDA's, all the rules that you have to do if you have compact fluorescence in your home, including how you need to get rid of it because it's such a toxic waste. So it's a dilemma. I know we have energy problems, but I'm saying we gotta find better solutions.
It's
And it is called an LED, yes. Okay, so by the way, if you have adrenal exhaustion, and you'll know, one of the ways you'll know it is if you wake up, and you know, if you have low blood pressure, by the way, you usually have an adrenal issue that's traditionally low like mine. But if you exercise and you are exhausted and feel worse after you exercise rather than feeling invigorated, it's a sign that your adrenals are really compromised and you're on reserve and you've just emptied the reserve tank. And you need to do gentle exercise, and that would be, you know, the Tai Chi, the yoga, gentle walking. Because if you exercise too vigorously with adrenal exhaustion, you are just, it's just depleted and your tank's on empty. So obviously we need to look at some foods. Cruciferous vegetables are traditionally known to help with liver detoxification, particularly if the liver is toxic when it is trying to eliminate and metabolize estrogens out of the body. It will metabolize the estrogens into a more toxic, potent form that generally gets reabsorbed. So you can become estrogen dominant because you are compromised in your liver's ability to metabolize, and then you're just increasing it endogenously. So cruciferous vegetables, and personally, I recommend you cook them, steam them, ferment them, even though Dave wouldn't agree, if maybe not your best choice, because they can really compromise thyroid function raw. Okay, thyroid, 28 million people are hypothyroid. 1 out of 9 have autoimmune diseases. I had Hashimoto's thyroiditis. I healed all that stuff naturally. So salva seeds, which you're going to get to try, you have a recipe with. These are actually, I feel they're superior to flax seeds in a number of ways. They have higher amounts of omega-3s. They have more fiber. They have more vitamins and minerals. They have more soluble protein than soy. They have high antioxidant levels. They're very stable. I was very surprised if they had any toxin because of the high antioxidant levels. They're phenomenal. And they're very healing for the digestive system, and they're gluten-free.
And just to clarify, if they're fermented with the right microbial stuff, that's fine. And if they're done in a controlled laboratory, which is obviously our, that doesn't mean it's bad.
Yeah. You know, fermented foods have a long tradition, if they're done right, to really support digestion and be able to absorb nutrients more easily, especially if you're compromised. And they've always been, throughout all cultures, been used to help digestion. What I learned in studying Chinese medicine is that the number one key to good health, the most fundamental thing you need to do, is keep your digestive strong. Digestion is the key to good health, and unfortunately, 70% of people are gluten intolerant. And if you're gluten intolerant, you'll have inflammation in your gut, you'll wear down your villi, you can't absorb and assimilate your nutrients, you have leaky gut, set up all these chronic illnesses, and away we go. So you've got, and over the age of 35, the body naturally tends to slow down in its ability to produce digestive enzymes. It's probably younger now because we're eating such processed foods, so we can't really keep up with the demand to produce all these digestive enzymes. So we all should be taking some good digestive enzymes and probably, as I do, some hydrochloric acid as well. So, by the way, salt, sea salt, Himalayan salt, really important for adrenal support. The adrenals really need the minerals in those whole salts. Okay, so I'm going to move through here. So I mentioned a little about salva, and I have an article that I wrote that gives you pretty good information of why this is a nutrient-dense food. One thing I want to say very briefly that I find quite fascinating, there's a new branch of science now called nutrigenomics. You heard about it in this group? Probably have. Basically, it's saying that we can alter our genes, and if you eat high-quality, nutrient-dense foods, you can turn on genes, turn off genes, you can make your genetic imprint much more powerful and alter your gene expression. And it affects your metabolism and your hormones. We can alter our genes, and it requires high-quality food. We're all needing to find nutrient-dense food, highly mineralized food, food that's high in the, you know, all the key nutrients. And we can alter our genes. And I believe there are many foods out there. Salva is one of those choices. Few other things that are really of interest, that what we have done and how it's setting up generations to be hormonally out of balance, because no child is born without synthetic chemicals. How many? About 286. And what are some of the consequences of that? We now have something that really hasn't existed before, and that's 1 out of 6 8-year-olds are going into puberty, little boys and little girls. And what does that do? That the earlier you have estrogen circulating in your body, the more likely, or the greater the risk will be of developing breast cancer in life. And for the boys, it's creating testosterone issues, greater risk of testicular cancer. These kids are more prone to have major behavioral problems, more suicides, as well as who knows what they're being programmed for later in life. I do want to talk about glutathione a bit, because inflammation is such a major problem related to hormonal imbalances. Estrogen increases inflammatory response. There are a few things that I've come across recently that I wanted to share with you, Salva being one. There's another product that Adria has here called GXL. glutathione. How many people know about glutathione? Ever heard of glutathione? Very good. So you know it's the master antioxidant. It's the powerful anti-inflammatory. It produces ATP, which is your energy, on a cellular level, and it's necessary to help detoxify toxins and heavy metals out of the body. Autistic children are compromised in glutathione. They can't get rid of mercury and other heavy metals, for instance. So glutathione, while it's phenomenal, it's made by every single cell of our body, it's also used up a lot, and they haven't really found a way to get a glutathione vitamin, because it's destroyed in the stomach and it just isn't easily taken in except with IVs. Although IVs oxidize quickly, it's good for about 2 weeks. I don't know if anyone has seen the video on the internet, but you see very compromised, progressed Parkinson patients struggling, can't turn 180 degrees, you know what Parkinson's like. And they were given IV of glutathione. 15 minutes later, they're skipping down the hallway. Unbelievable, but it doesn't last, because it's quickly oxidized out of the body. So, I don't know, I'm looking for solutions. So there's a product that is made by a Dr. Keller, who has worked, voted one of the top 2,000 doctors in the 21st century. He's very renowned. He has worked with HIV patients and cancer patients, and he's put together a patented product that has all the precursors that have supposedly increased your glutathione levels. And there was a published study just came out about a month or two ago that showed 2 months of taking GXL on the patients increased glutathione levels by 300%. But interestingly enough, it also increased DHEA, which is an important youthing hormone, by about 30 or 40%, and reduced intracellular inflammation by about another 40%. So something you may want to look at. I personally use it, and it helps with pain, it helps with energy, it helps for sports people to recover, because it helps clear out the free radicals and inflammation.
Can you put the reference for that, please? I just want to call the attention to people. One of the people in our community, Tim Guilford, has a wonderful product, Liposomal Glutathione. And what's it called?
Ready Sore.
So if you want to ask me about that, I'll tell you the website and go on.
Great. You know, I think glutathione is the next big thing. We just have to find products that are able to, I can get you the reference, I don't have it right here. We just have to find those products, and there's never just one thing out there. I'm just sharing some of the things I've come across, but there are things coming available to help us deal with the crisis of the 21st century. And that's all I'm interested in. And if something's working, if there's some science behind it, people are getting relief, let's look into it. And I really have come to appreciate how important glutathione is, and the great dilemma, because those who live to 100 have the highest glutathione levels, but you can't take it as a supplement, so how do you get it? And while there are precursors that can help us, there are formulas around and products that make it much more efficient, and it's verifiable. So that's good to know, you know? I personally like thermography for breast screening. So I have to say that digital infrared thermography, looking at heat patterns, can be used as a screening method for detecting potential problems years earlier than would ever show up in mammogram. What's the problem with mammogram? The American Cancer Society, not my favorite organization, has one good thing to say. They say there are no safe levels of radiation. That's what they say. I agree. So mammograms can increase your risk of what? Breast cancer. Kind of crazy, especially because when you look at some of the statistics, is that breast cancer has to grow big enough, the doubling of the cells, to be seen in an X-ray, and generally that's when it's been growing in your body for 8 years. When you get a mammogram, it's already been in your body and big enough to be seen. When you do non-invasive, non-toxic digital infrared thermography by qualified people, you can detect something brewing when it's only been in your body for 2 years, and then you can take decisive steps to change your destiny. Not like a woman who called me up and was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she said, you know, my doctor spotted something 5 years ago. So every year I go in and have an exam, and he says, yep, that problem's still there. Yep, you got something there. And then 5 years down the track, full-blown breast cancer. That's not my definition of preventative medicine. So I have never had a mammogram, but I get regular thermography. And I think it gives so much information. And now that younger and younger women are at risk of breast cancer, you can't give a mammogram to a 25-year-old, even though they are, because they have denser breast tissue, and they're going to have more mammograms in their lifetime, which is going to increase their risk of breast cancer.
You can do MRIs.
You can do MRIs, but they're invasive, too, and they have consequences. Well, they're expensive. If we have nothing else to say, they're expensive, and if you have a couple of $1,000 to do a mammogram, I don't know what the going rate is, that's great. But digital infrared thermography, it's $150, $200, and non-invasive and readily available.
Len Saputo in Lafayette does that. So it's a really good diagnostic technique.
Yeah, I'm sure you know who the resources are.
Right.
Look into it, women, because it's a true screening technique. Mammograms, ultrasound, are for diagnostic purposes. Something suspicious, you want to check it out, that's when you use a mammogram. It is not for semi-annual or annual screening. High number of false positives, a lot of problems, as you probably know. So, melatonin, the latest issue of Life Extension magazine, have you read it lately? There's a good article about melatonin. It's getting a lot more profile. It's a really important hormone, which is no longer just made in your pineal gland. We now know it's made throughout the body, which is pretty interesting. But it's profound in its role in helping our health. So most of us know about melatonin because of it regulating sleep cycles. And if you're traveling like me, you get jet lag or you want to prevent it, you take melatonin. But it turns out melatonin helps to maintain proper levels of intracellular communication. Pretty important if you want your body to work. So the cells are communicating. It also turns out that melatonin suppresses estrogen levels, inhibiting breast, prostate, ovarian, skin cancers, even colon cancers are related to melatonin levels. It protects it. Coordinates fertility, but it also protects against genetic damage. And it regulates sexual development. I wonder if those kids with precocious puberty who maybe use their cell phones a lot, which suppresses melatonin, could be, you know, exposed to things that are suppressing proper regulation of melatonin. But here's the most important, and it's a tumor suppressor, and women with breast cancer are put on up to 50 milligrams of melatonin as part of their protocol. Melatonin is really important hormone. Now, EMFs, electromagnetic frequencies from electrical appliances, and the range that also includes microwave radiation from cell phones, cordless phones, wireless routers, Wi-Fis, all of these things are enough to suppress melatonin. In fact, if you sleep next to a digital clock, that puts out enough EMFs to suppress melatonin levels at night when you sleep. How bad is that? Pretty bad. Night shift workers, they're up at night, have a 60% increased incidence of breast cancer directly related to suppression of melatonin. And women with the lowest levels of melatonin were 70 times more likely to develop breast cancer. So we must support our body's ability to produce melatonin. And one of the things that actually is suppressing melatonin production happens to be the proliferation of EMFs. So I want to talk a bit about EMFs. We've had this conversation. I am very involved in this issue. I've talked to people all over the world. I've written about it. I want to share some of the things I am learning. This is probably the biggest health crisis we are facing, but it's invisible. It's been suppressed. We have been lied to about it. You know, it took 100 years from the time it was first noticed that asbestos was causing serious harm before governments banned it. I hope it doesn't take 100 years by the time it's recognized that EMFs have been a primary toxin exacerbating all other toxins. Dave, you know, is talking about the mole thing. Well, I want to share a quote that I heard from Dietrich Klinghart. Have you heard of Dietrich Klinghart? A renowned doctor out of Seattle who is very fundamental in his work with autism and looking at the mercury connection. And he believes that EMFs are a huge problem. He also believes that they exacerbate microorganisms and mitotoxins, biotoxin output by 600%.
There's really good evidence to support that, that anything you do that stresses those things causes their toxin output to go up dramatically. It's a defensive behavior to the stress that's caused. It's a standard thing to do even when they're using them to produce the chemicals, like in a factory that's using fermentation to create pharmaceuticals. They heat them and they use EMS and whatever else they can to basically piss off the fungus because it gets more toxic. So the evidence is right there.
So your cell phones and your wireless routers and your Bluetooth, if you're not protected, and I'm going to tell you what I found is protection, because I personally do not believe these warnings that we're getting to reduce your cell phone use and shut it off. It doesn't matter anymore, because we live in a wireless world. We are now creating WiMAX. I think San Francisco was trying to do WiMAX. What's that? It's covering an entire 30-mile radius, but the antennas, the WiMAX towers go out 3,000 square miles. We are now, there's a new product out there in the market, FemtoCell. Has anyone ever heard of FemtoCell? Who's heard of it? Have you heard of it? FemtoCell, if you're not getting great reception of your phone in your home, you now can put a mini cell phone tower right there in your home.
All right, I've got a question on that one. It turns out I have one of those in my house for health reasons. I have it there because it means that the cell phones in my house and my neighbors will be broadcasting at a very low signal strength instead of at a high one. So I'd rather that they use an antenna on the top of my house than the antenna next to my head to broadcast. It seems defensive to me.
Well, that is a good theory if you think that lowering the output is safe. But according to the research, what we have found is that there are no safe levels of exposure because the damage is immediate, not from the thermal effects, although there are thermal effects happening now. It's from the non-thermal effects. It's the frequency, the information carrying radio waves, the frequencies, man-made frequencies that carry those packets of information that let you take your camera, take your pictures, and talk on, you know, have the emails and all that stuff. These are man-made frequencies, and the emission of those frequencies from the antennas. And, you know, your cordless phone is a little cell phone tower in your home, more powerful than your cell phone.
Where's the evidence?
Oh, I have the evidence. I'll give you the evidence. There are thousands of articles out there, and I can lead you to all the sites. Because, so really, we want the evidence. Hang on one sec. Well, just give me a sec. So what's happening is that The exposure is immediate because the cells perceive these man-made frequencies as though they were toxic invaders never known before, and they go not just into protective mode, but they get compromised and their cell membranes are altered, and now we have a situation where there is DNA damage, where there's a breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, the cell membranes, the receptor sites are compromised. Heavy metals are exacerbated by the exposure to EMF, so if you have heavy metals in your body, it's actually worsening your toxic load. We have complications to this issue we have never known before.
Email the doctor and she'll send me back the international studies and how in this country, how we've been saying, well, you know, they're only like 0.6 microwatt or something like that. And yet in European countries, that's probably hundreds of times above the standards that they consider safe on the human body.
You know, there's a lot of voices being raised right now, and saw Larry King maybe a couple of months ago, Dr. Vinny Khurana, neurosurgeon out of Canberra, Australia, very vocal. He says a couple of really important things. First of all, we have arrived at the 10-year period. It takes 10 years to develop brain tumors. 2008 is the time when we've been using cell phones intensively enough to now see the epidemic incidence of brain tumors. Who's he most concerned about? Our children. There's a paper that came out linking the autism, increased incidence of autism with exposure to EMFs, maybe because of all the things we're talking about, the heavy metals, the breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, genetic damage. We are seeing Dr. Heberman, who's head of the University of Pittsburgh Cancer Center, who said, we have a serious problem here. He can't wait for the science because the evidence is becoming overwhelming, and our children are at greatest risk.
I just gave a lecture at a conference on this issue you're talking about. Here's the answer to what's happening. It's causing excitation. That's the major problem, what all these frequencies are doing. Think of your heart, it vibrates at 1 hertz. And it's the heart vibrates at 1 cycle per second, and it's below 1 to 3 milli amps. So it's very low current. It's in a nano current technology. Our heart vibrates at. These outputs are causing overexcitation for our cells. It's changing what's called the ceramide pathway, which is the lipid pathway that controls all gene expression in our body. And what's happening is dehydrating the cells is causing communication damage. So we have what's like scar tissue developing. It's replication because the signaling conduction that our cells are going through is now destroyed because of these electromagnetic fields at these high amperage and currents. So you're having a lot more than just all these things. And this is the evidence that's been proven. And I gave a lecture in front of about 250 world experts from Israel, Sweden, and Denmark, and UC Berkeley, and Bruce Ames, and who was there also, the virologist from UC Berkeley, who spoke about this as well, the HIV expert. I forgot, I can't think of that.
Well, the BioInitiative report. Right. So the BioInitiative.org, this is a 610-page report put out by leading scientists who have been at the forefront of doing research. They're non-industry sponsored researchers. And the BioInitiative report looks at the consequences affecting brain tumors, brain damage, neurological problems, immune dysfunction, hormone imbalances, DNA damage, and heat shock protein. So it's all there. There's huge evidence. Now, I want to just say a couple of things. we have to find help, because no one's giving up this technology. We have 2 million antennas and cell phone towers in the United States. We are wireless, whether we like it or not. 90% of the planet is wireless. There are cell phone towers on the Himalayas. We are in the wireless age. In 25 years, we have blanketed the planet, and the plants, the bees, the animals are suffering as well. And what are we going to do? We're going to stop using our cell phone? Well, it's a good idea, but it doesn't matter, because the ambient radiation is so strong now that we are all being affected. And we can do a little demonstration later if you want. I can show you what's happening when you're on your cell phone, what it's doing to your body. So. Well, fortunately, I want to say I have found a technology. It's not the only technology. I'm sure there's others out there, but I have come across a technology. I've just written another article. It's based on science. Even Cedars-Sinai Hospital's done research on this technology, based on nanotech. It's based on noise field technology. Some of you may have heard of the company BioPro. There's very sound science. There have been some studies just done out of India, very impressive studies that I've just documented evidence in a new article that's coming out. Personally, all I can say is personally, I would not use any technology, whether a cell phone, wireless router, cordless phone, computers, or any of these other technologies without this passive noise field technology chip. And that's what I personally have chose to use. I'm satisfied. Now, the reason why none of these other ways of testing have shown any effect, because this does not alter the output of your phone. It's not changing the radiation that's coming out. If you did that, you wouldn't get a signal. What it does is it superimposes a frequency on that man-made frequency that the cells perceive as toxic. So it camouflages the frequency so the cells can't see it. It cloaks it. And if the cells don't see it, it's changing the biological response into a, it stops any reactive response because it becomes invisible to the cells. So it's the impact of this technology is not altering the radiation. You'll never see any difference in the radiation. It's altering the frequency, the waveform that's emitted, so the cells do not perceive it as a toxic frequency. It's cloaked. Does that make sense in a very, there's science, and I'm happy to give you the science, because it has been shown. And I will show you, make up your own mind. You know, you have to make up your own mind. But here's what Dr. Heberman says, and I would agree. You have to err on the side of safety. You have to find whatever it is that you feel comfortable with, that you can use on your technology and on your body to protect you, to err on the side of safety, because down the track, and according to Dr. Khurana, within 5 years, there will be no longer any question about the danger of this technology.
One way to relieve all this problem we have, and it's been proven by all the committee that I was attending to, is positive attitude. It's really your attitude towards anything that is coming into your body. You can actually change the gene expression in ways you think about something. And the same thing with food. It's you got to make a positive attitude and don't allow the negativity of all these electronics and cell phones, because you will create what you want in your own cells. So positive attitude is very powerful in this.
Well, I agree. But very few of us have the strength of that intention to protect us from a technology that is so harmful. And I would like us to all be able to go there. Ram Dass's guru taking LSD and going, nothing happening. I'm sure we can all be there at some place. But I want to wrap a few things up, because I know it's getting late. The message that I want to really say is it's about balance. And we're talking about hormones. And by the way, just one more little point on the EMF thing. If you go to my website, whatwomenmustknow.com, First of all, if you go to whatwomenmustknow.com, there's a fabulous free report on the myths and truths about hormones. So you just have to put your name and their email address, you'll get the free report. But there is a page of free articles. And on that page, there are numerous articles, and there's one of them about EMFs, hormones, and cell phones. And this is the research I've gathered on all the hormonal consequences of exposure to EMFs, whether it's a lot of electrical appliances, which we have 1 to 200 million times more than our grandparents ever had exposure to, or the proliferation of the wireless technology affecting our thyroid, affecting our, you know, pineal gland, the melatonin levels, raising estrogen, suppressing testosterone, raising cortisol, causing infertility, miscarriages, huge issues. And that article is there if you want to go read and learn more about it on the website, okay? I also have a radio show that's archived. It's called What Women Must Know. And if you go to my website, there's a link to the radio show, which you can listen to at your leisure. And I interview all sorts of people and invite some of you to come on and talk about the things too. Yeah?
I read that low levels of frequency can be even more dangerous than the higher levels because the body's defense is immediately activated. And also that some of the things like Bluetooth actually don't stop the radiation unless they improve, since I read the article about them.
Bluetooth is not safe. It never will be safe. All Bluetooth is a little receiver in your ear of a wireless technology. And it doesn't matter if it's a lower amount of exposure, because that's not the type of frequency that is harming your body. It's the non-thermal effect, not the heat, not the intensity. So I just think you're setting yourself up for more problems, because now it's right in your ear canal. Okay, yeah. But you have to understand this. It doesn't matter what the SAR rating is. It's the non-thermal effect. As soon as you turn that phone on and it makes a connection, or just as you have it on, it's altering the energy of the body. It doesn't matter what your SAR levels are, or little up or little down. So I from my investigations, that's not the issue, the SAR levels. And all SAR levels are heating up your brain tissue anyway, which they said it didn't do, but they are. Yeah.
What was Dr. Keller's formula of the
glutathione? The GXL. The company is Max International. His product is known as GXL. Go to maxgxl.com. And he has the PowerPoint of his presentation.
I have 10 of those boxes here that I'm selling. And also the yellow order form. If people will fill it in, I'll place the order.
So talk to Adria. She's got some product if you're interested. I mean, I personally take it myself. Okay, yeah.
Can you say something about the polycystic ovarian syndrome?
Oh, polycystic ovarian syndrome. Okay, this is the result of lots of follicles being matured or trying to be matured in the ovaries, but they never really mature and they never really dissolve. They're finding that these conditions are really insulin resistance. It's about generally... the result of too much sugar in the system, and we're becoming insulin resistant. And it creates more testosterone receptors, so women who have polycystic ovarian syndrome tend to have more facial hair, more male hormone issues. They tend to get male pattern baldness, hairier in general, more acne, and infertility issues. So, you know, I mean, there's definitely a relationship with insulin resistance, and these people who I've talked to definitely have sugar cravings, which could be the candida. You know, a lot of our sugar cravings are because our fungus needs to be fed by sugar, so overrides all willpower. And as we heal the fungus or the candida issues and heal our gut and less cravings, we actually can start resolving things. So that has to be looked at. So you really need to do glycemic control with your diet and, Look at digestion, look at liver. It's a holistic thing. But that's how it's manifesting a lot of women now. And probably a toxic condition as well. Some other questions? Yeah. Well, they put out a lot of EMFs, and I know people who, I don't know if they're still doing it, putting the battery under the driver's seat, but I know people who've turned their cars in because they felt so sick with those batteries emitting large amounts of EMFs. You know, every solution has their own problems.
I did that, by the way. I got rid of my Prius.
Yeah. You don't want to be sitting on a battery emitting high amounts of EMFs. A couple of things I want to say before I forget. I have done a really big special for you guys. I have some products with me. I have my book. It's usually $25. It's $15 for this crowd. I have a 3-CD set, 3 hours, called Getting Your Hormones Back on Track. It's all this information, a whole lot more than we're sharing tonight. I have a CD called Wise Women Collection. It's half a dozen or more of my in-depth articles, 44 pages of information on tamoxifen, hysterectomies, the myths of menopause, the pill, osteoporosis, all the myths, and a 45-minute lecture on progesterone. And I have a one-hour CD on the dangers of EMFs and hormones. If you bought all this stuff at the retail price, it would be close to $100, and I'm putting it all together in a package for $55 if you want the whole thing. And if you want individual things, they're all discounted anyway. So I just really want this information to be out there and shared. And Breast Cancer Awareness Month is coming up, and we have Christmas. This kind of information is going to come from a grassroots level. It's coming from the bottom up, and I just encourage everyone to get informed, educated, empowered with the truth. So thanks a lot, and I'll be around.
Okay,
I'll give you my address. Yeah.